and your future determines what you will become in life. In the name of Jesus Christ, God bless you, man of God. So many people are caught up in their past and they don't know how to metamorphose to their future. Let's go to Genesis chapter 12. Genesis 12. I want you to see verse 1. We are just reading 1 to 4. The Bible says that there was a man called Abraham. The man was coming from a very strong family, idol worshiping family. But God saw his heart. God knew that the man was going to be great and that he will obey him. God decided to build a new world on this man. In Genesis chapter 12, the Bible says, now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to the land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and I will make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. Everything about this is great. It's awesome. But Abraham has been in his father's house 75 years. How can you abandon 75 years that you know what it's going to bring to even the next one day that you don't know what it will bring? It's tough. So that's why we're talking about your past versus your future. So Abraham now, his father died in Haran. His brother died in Haran. He has relaxed. He was ready to go. He said, this is where, this is home. God said, get out from there. And many times, many of us have said, get out. We say, I can't get out. Because here is guaranteed food. Here is guaranteed shelter. And God is saying, go to somewhere that you don't know what it will bring. And you say, no, I can't go to my future. I'd rather stay in my past and die. And many people have stayed in their past and died. Every time God shows up, there's something new. He said, I will do a new thing now. It shall spring forth. Have you not known it? I will even make a way in the desert. And water shall spring out of the wilderness. So God is guaranteeing you that this thing, but look at this man of 75 years. One, he doesn't know this God. There is no blueprint of what God has done before that he can read upon to accept. But the Bible said the man was a wise man. The Bible said, verse 3, he said, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who cursed you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. The Bible says, verse 4, so Abraham departed. It is scary, but he went with his future. He followed his future. His father's house was his past. But God said, go to somewhere else. And that place, God is just promising things. He has not seen anything. The Bible says, and Abraham departed as the Lord has spoken to him. And Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Hallelujah. Then Abraham took Sarah, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed and go to the land of Canaan. Many of you today, you will see that God has spoken to you long before now to leave your past and go into your future. But because we refuse, everything that happened in our past will happen to us. If you look at Abraham, his father died in Haran. His father, the original destination, if you go to Genesis 11, was Canaan. When they were coming down, they said, we are going to go to Canaan. And his father never saw Canaan. He died in Haran. His brother also died in Haran. So Abraham has concluded that Haran is now home. But God said, no, Canaan will be the new home. Let's go to Canaan. So Abraham departed, not knowing where. God did not mention Canaan. You know how God works. Sometimes God will dislocate you so he can relocate you. Many times we are so comfortable that we can't relocate. Then it will be a police case. It can be a divorce. It can be something that will shift the foundation of your life. The fabric. Sometimes it will be a job loss. in your quest to get another job, you locate your destiny. You go to the place that God wanted you to go originally. But because you had that job and you were comfortable, God said, go down there. You say, no, I can't go to downtown. I'm good with Gwinnett County. Until you lose everything in Gwinnett, you will not find downtown. So when God dislocates you, he will take everything.
Yeah.
He will strip you naked.
Yes.
In fact, sometimes you act like a madman or a mad woman. Things will not be what it's supposed to be. People will ask you, are you crazy? How can a man of 75 begin to go abroad? In our time, it's almost impossible. When you are getting to 60, you are getting close to home. But now God said, get out, 75, you are a young man. Get out. Abandon everything. Leave home. Is this not something that you can do with a straight face? You must have heard from God. If you see a man that is carrying a lot of bag on the airport, or see them on the park traveling and they have 3, 4, 5 luggages, they are not coming back tomorrow. That man is going on a long journey. Hallelujah. So Abraham began to gather everything. But if somebody does have a backpack, you know they are coming back. I don't care how what they tell you. If somebody have a backpack and say, I'm going to be for 1 year, I'll be back. Don't worry, next week you are seeing them back. They are not ready. For you to go on a long journey, you have to be prepared. You have to carry everything that you need to carry. Because the route back is not easy. Because you go there, you don't know what you're going to see. You must get enough food, enough money. You have to carry everything. The Bible says Abraham carried all. Everything he had, he gathered them and not followed them. But God is going to shock him. Everything he depended on, the resources he had, he's going to lose them also. That is the way of God. Look at verse 10 of that Genesis chapter 12. The man has obeyed God. You think that things will start to work for him? No. The Bible said now there was famine. When he has left, there was nothing to fall back to. Accounts have been closed. Probably you have had some bad relationships because people say don't leave while you left. They say when you come back, don't call me. So now he got to the place. There was famine there. And he lost everything. Because God wants him to depend on him. You don't have to depend on the little money you came with. So the Bible says, and there was famine in the land. And Abraham went down. A man that was managing where he was, God took him out. He came to Canaan. He lost everything. So he said, now, since Canaan didn't work, let's go to Egypt. Let's keep going until we find this place that God is saying. But God has already prepared the man. Remember when he came to Canaan, he raised an altar for God and called the place El Shaddai. Hallelujah. So when he left Canaan, and as they were going to Egypt, he felt something. He said, my wife is a beautiful woman. Say, let me tell you something. As we get into this land, men will look for you. And probably they have more money than I. Tell them that you are my sister so they don't kill me. He didn't know he was prophesying to his future. As they crossed the border, the first people they saw was secret service. And they said, wow, this is good for the king. We have to take her for the king. And now, they say, who is she to you? Say, she's my sister. And they carried all of them. So Abraham had become an in-law to the king. And they brought them to the palace. And they made them comfortable. So they have to train the woman on the way of the palace. Because you can't just meet the king. You have to go through Fatima. You have to teach you the culture, the dressing. So while they were doing that, God was showing Abraham administration. God was showing Abraham servants. God was showing him wealth. Because before God can take you to your future, he will show you pictures. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Many of you have not been there yet, but as once in a while you get some glimpse of success. You get into some place that you don't expect to be. I remember when I was in South Africa, in the midst of suffering, in the midst of, I didn't have a house. I've told that story here somehow. I was living in a garage. There is no hot water. It was winter. It was cold. So what we do, we soak the towel in the water and you squeeze it. And you clean your body. You can't shower. If you shower, you will die the next moment because the cold was -5, -6. I lived there for 3 months. But do you know, I was there when God connected me to one of the ladies I worked with, American Embassy, and they had this big event that they were doing. The president was there, so she invited me to that event. And here comes a homeless man. I took off my African attire, one of the best, it was my father's clothes then that I had. I took it, that dressed up. And me and my friend, we came to this event, but we have the invitation. Rich men were turned down. You must enter with invitation. The biggest people in South Africa, and the president was there, the vice president, the economic people, all kinds of people, ambassadors of different nations, American ambassador, Chinese ambassador, all of them were there.
Wow.
We came in, we had a table that had our name. Me and the guy, we sat down there. And I began to look, what is going on here? And here comes this lady looking at me. She came and touched my hand. She said, oh, I love this dress. This cloth is very old. But that was the contact. And she kept looking at my clothes, said she liked it. She took pictures with us. She said, give me your number. So I told the guy that was with me, I said, give him your number. I don't have a phone. So she thought the guy was my personal assistant. She took the number. And when she called the next day and said she wanted to speak to me, the guy said, I'm not with him. He said, go and give the phone to your boss. And the guy was mad. The guy dropped the phone and came to me and said, who is this lady that is calling me and saying, give him? I said, I don't know who she is. So she called again, said her name. And she introduced the guy, told the guy where I met her. And they brought the phone to me. When I talked to her, she said I should call. She said, I want to have a direct line to you. I said, I don't have a phone. She said, don't tell me a lie. I said, I don't have a phone. She said, if you don't have a phone, meet me at Sancton City, at Michelangelo. And I went there. But now, how can I get her? Because this guy don't want to have anything to do with me again. He has been told that he was my servant, so he was mad. So I don't have anybody to go with me. So I went, jumped the bus, came to Sancton City, went to this Michelangelo Hotel. I was in like a shopping place. People were walking by, everybody. I don't know this lady. I've never seen her before. I met her once. I can't remember how she looked like. And she would call the guy. The guy would say, I'm there. So I'll go and put the money in the pay, in the coin pay in those days. I don't know if he's still here now. But you put the coin and you dial the number. I'll call her and say, where are you? I said, I'm here. Where? I would describe the place. Then she would tell me where she was. I would go there. I'll be looking at a lot of white people. I don't know who this lady is. So she said, stay where you are. Tell me where you are coming there. She came. I said, okay, how are you? We walked in. She said, now this is a phone shop. Take any phone you want. I will pay for it.
Glory.
And by then, there's a phone called Samsung Blue Eye. When you press it, it shifts up. It was sold about $3,500.
Yeah.
You flip it.
Yeah.
That was the highest phone on earth there. I said, that's what I want. When God gives you a blank check, fill whatever you want.
Yes.
She paid for it. I took out my SIM card, put it, and connected. She called me and said, okay, now I will call you back. The rest became story. From her, I got a house in Sandy City. I got a car. In less than 1 month, I was living in the biggest area in Johannesburg.
Amen.
Just behind American Embassy. Well secured on Rivonia Road. But when God wanted to, but that was not my. God will show you pictures before he take you to your future. I thought Sancton City was it. Until I found myself in America. I said, whoa. That's how God does. He will show you glimpses. So he took Abraham to the palace to show him wealth. Because he's about to give him that wealth. Now Abraham is enjoying the wealth of Pharaoh. But before Pharaoh will marry the wife, God came knocking. Say, don't touch her. She is my son's wife. And Pharaoh said, what? And came to Abraham, why didn't you tell me that she's your wife? I could have been with her. But your God came to me. He said, now get out of my country. And they began to pack gold.
Yeah.
They began to pack cattle. They began to give him wealth.
Yeah.
Genesis chapter 13, verse 1.
Yeah.
The Bible said, then Abraham went out from Egypt. And he and his wife and all that he had and Lot with him. Verse 2, and Abraham was very rich. He never worked in that land. God sent him to Egypt to bless him. Because he needed money to start. God said, I'm going to give you the money. But the money is in the hand of Pharaoh. But I have to connect you to Pharaoh through your wife. And that is how you are going to be blessed. And Abraham came out. The Bible says he went straight back to Canaan. And he came to his altar. And he made sacrifice. And he raised up all together. He praised God and called it El Shaddai. Rabagashikoto. Let's go further. 2 Samuel chapter 4. Thank you, Jesus. 2 Samuel chapter 4. I want you to see verse 4. Yes, Lord. Say, Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son who was lame in his feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came to Jezreel, and his lords took him up and fled. And it happened as she made haste to flee that he fell and became lame. His name was Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth. That was the name of the boy. Then now we are going to move further. 2 Samuel chapter 9. This was how the boy became lame. But look at this boy. When David has become king, hallelujah, David made a covenant with Jonathan. Remember, we are going to read it in 1 Samuel 18. He told Jonathan, say, look, Jonathan saw him and knew that this guy, the way he's going, something is about to happen to him. Great things. Jonathan was supposed to be the next king. But he relinquished his position for David. And he said, David, make a covenant with me that if you become king, you will not maltreat us. I will still be your body. David said, don't worry, I agree with that. He said, and if I die, you will take care of my family. I don't know why he said that. So now, 2 Samuel chapter 9, I want us to see verse 4. So the king said to him, where is he? It is about, David now has become king and has he reigned. Jonathan has died long time. David now is thinking, one day, you know, sometimes God will put people in your heart. David forgot the covenant that he made with Jonathan. He has become so rich. One day he said, is there any man left in the house of Saul that I will show him mercy because of Jonathan? And they say, yes, there's a boy called Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan. Ah, David was angry. And the Bible says he called a servant in verse 4. So the king said to him, where is he? And the man said, at Ziba, said to the king, indeed he is in the house of Machia, the son of Amiel, in Ledoba. Then King David sent and brought him out of the house of Machia, the son of Amiel, from Ledoba. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, had come to David, he fell on his face and prostrated himself. Then David said to him, Mephibosheth, and he answered, here is your servant. Verse 7. So David said to him, do not fear, for I will surely show you kindness for Jonathan, your father's sake, and will restore to you all the land of Saul, your grandfather, and you shall eat bread at my table continually. So Mephibosheth was restored. But Mephibosheth, his name was, the meaning of his name is extraction of shame. When his mother came back to him, he, whether consciously or unconsciously, I don't know why, the mother called him the person that would remove shame. Extraction of shame. That's the name, the meaning of Mephibosheth. But here comes, there was a war, and the whole house of Saul is being killed. So the nurse and their maid picked the boy. The boy was 5 years old. Picked the boy and ran. As she was running, the boy fell and broke his legs. And she ran and handed him to somebody in Ledoba. The boy has become a man now. He has grown, but he was lame. And this is a grandson of a king. They had a palace. They had servants. They had everything. was left in a dry land to die. In fact, if you read further, the beard in his beard, he had not shaved probably since he had beard in his life. His hair was so long, his beard was so, that the king looked at him, the king was ashamed. And they have to clean him up. But this guy, his name is Extraction of Shame. Someone that will take away shame. How did he end up in shame? But David said, bring him. But let's go back to the story of Jonathan and David. 1 Samuel chapter 18. I want you to see that your past should remain your past. Don't take your past to your future. After David has killed Goliath, David has become the biggest name in Israel. And that, you know, women know how to give somebody away. In fact, women are the one that caused the war between David and Saul. Saul didn't hate him at first. He saw him as a subordinate that did well. Saul promoted him and gave him the highest rank in the military. And if you look at verse 1 of 1 Samuel chapter 18, now when he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was kicked to the soul of David. The prince saw the boy when he was talking to his father, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore. Verse 3, then Jonathan and David made a covenant. That was the covenant. Jonathan already knew that this guy will be someone. Jonathan and David made a covenant. Hallelujah. Because he loved him as his own. And Jonathan took off his robe that was on him and gave it to David with his arm, even his sword and his bow and his belt. So David went out wherever Saul sent him and behaved wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all the people also, and in the sight of Saul's servant. Now it happened as they were coming home from the battle now, when David was returning from the slaughter of the Philistine, that the women are the one that caused this trouble. That the women, they were not in battle. The Bible said the women saw David and said, Saul has killed 1,000, but David has killed 10,000. And the king now became very angry. I just promoted this guy, gave him everything, gave him my daughter to marry. Now women are beginning to praise David in front of the king. I want you to see it. In verse 7. So women sang as they danced and say, Saul has slain his 1,000 and David has slain 10,000. And they continued to sing that song. And that song was what brought the war. So Saul began to look at this boy and say, I love this boy, but I'm going to kill him. He was a king. If you read that, the Bible says, and there was a long war between the house of David and the house of Saul. But David already had a covenant with Jonathan that both of them are going to be buddies, that they will love each other, they will be together forever. But now Saul is making a war to kill David. So Jonathan is caught in between his father and his future, which is David, his friend. So many of us are like Jonathan. His father is guaranteed food, guaranteed house, royalty, shelter. But David was his future. So how can I separate from my father and go with David? I love my father, but I also love David. A lot of us are caught in between jobs, and there's an opportunity, but you have to drive a little longer. Say, how can I go there? This job is just behind my house. I don't have to drive, but that job will pay me better. Some people are caught between their past lives, drugs, humanizing, alcohol, drunkenness. You are caught in between. You have found the light, but you don't know what you are going to see in Christianity. You are stuck. Should I join them? Should I become a full-time Christian? Should I serve God? Or should I just stay with what I know? You are caught. That's what Jonathan was in the middle of David and his father. He didn't know where to go. So his father was his past. David was his future. If he go that he's going to die. Because he has seen the movement of God. David was the next frontier. David was the next power. David was the move of God. David was the next generation. But my father is comfortable. My father has shelter. My father has food. My father loved me. Should I stay with my father? Or should I go with David? That's what you are going to ask yourself. When God told Abraham, get out. Should I stay home and die? Or should I go? Because where I'm going, I don't know what is going to happen. I don't know what tomorrow brings. But home is guaranteed shelter. I'm guaranteed that I'll have at least 1 meal a day. I guarantee that I have people to walk around me. But if I go to this place, what will be of me? And many Christians will stay with their home, stay with their past, and what happened in their past will happen in their life. Jonathan, cry! Saul can provide for me now, but David will provide for me tomorrow, but I don't know. You know, tomorrow is ambiguous. We put a lot of emphasis on tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow will be. But this my father, I know he can feed me today. I love my father so, but I am in love with David. I'm in love with my future, but I love my parents. I love my family. Should I stay with them and continue to live the way I'm living? Or should I just get out and find a better life? I disagree with my father's policy. Because every time his father wants to kill David, Jonathan will go and tell David. He disagreed with his father. But he had a covenant with this guy. Should I continue with the covenant? Or should I break it? And the Bible says when the Philistines came and they made war with Israel, Jonathan decided to go with his father. He would have joined David in the cave of Adullam. And he would still be alive. Probably David would make him one of the generals in the military. But he said, no, I'm going to go to war with my father. And he went with his past. And he didn't make it. He died in that war. A lot of Christians have died because of their ancestral bloodline. This is what is obtainable in my family. I'm going to do what my father did. I'm going to do what my mother did. But if you look at the history of my father and my mother, they didn't make it to where God is showing me. I've seen a different path. Should I go with the path that I have seen, that I don't know how it's going to end, even though it is bright? Or should I stay here? Remember the four lepers at the entrance of the city? The Bible says, why should we stay here and die?
Amen.
If we go back to our brethren, there's no food, we will die here. If we stay here, we will die also. If we go to the Samaritans, they are going to feed us. The Samaritans, they have food. The Syrians, there is food there, but they are our enemy. So they might kill us or they might leave us. And the Bible said, they said, let's go to the enemy. The moment they began to take that step, God began to do the miracle. Because God will never show you everything. I don't care how he loves you. God will show you glimpse of your future. He will show you, he wants you to stretch your feet. God will tell you this is going to happen to you. But if you don't do it, it will happen. Now, what is the guarantee that if I do it, it will happen? There is no guarantee. Many of us, we have a reference point. We can read the word of God and see what he has done before. Some of these people don't have anywhere to reference to. They just have to go with their guts. They have to go with their will. They have to go with their spirit. They have to just believe that God will do what he said he will do. It's a promise. Everything in the Bible is about promises. But those promises, if you hold on to them, they come to pass. But if you reject them, you get the crumbs, which is not our portion. The Bible said the four lepers, they went into the camp of the Syrians. And the Syrians heard this noise of chariots. How can you await four men that were leprous men that had no toes walking, and people that were in the camp, military men, begin to hear the noise of chariots? That is the power of the omnipotent God. That is where the miracle begins to happen. Until you take that first step of faith and say, I'm going to get out of my past. I have seen my past and I know everything about it, but I don't know about my future. Until I walk into my future, I will not know what will happen. Let me tell you something. Your past and your future only exist in now. Because the next minute is our future. But until we get in there. Then it becomes a past. So your past and your future only exist now. When you are in your past, it was not past then, it is your present. So your past and your future exist in your present. So by next day, I remember in those days in Nigeria, when there's something that my mother used to put in her shop, no credit today, come tomorrow.
Wow.
So when you come in, you say, I need, can you just give me credit for $5? They say, no credit today, come tomorrow. So tomorrow you are ready, when you come back, it's there. Tomorrow never comes. Tomorrow exists today. Yesterday exists today. You can't get to tomorrow. Hallelujah. No credit tomorrow. Today, come tomorrow. Come tomorrow. You will come tomorrow. Tomorrow will have tomorrow. Tomorrow will have tomorrow. Every day has tomorrow. And tomorrow never comes. So why not just go with your cause and say, God, I gotta go. I gotta go with you now. I remember when Jacob was running away from his brother. He came to Bethel in Genesis 28. The Bible says God met him at the altar of Abraham. He slept in that stone. He saw the angels ascending and descending. And he woke up and said, the Lord is in this place, but I knew it not. Now that he found out, he raised an altar. He poured no oil. He said, God, if you can take me to where I'm going and bring me back, I will come here and I will make sacrifice. He couldn't have left. If you are going somewhere and you see God, why are you going again? Where are you going? If you are coming to church this morning and you meet Jesus Christ, He is church. I remember when Jesus went into the farm and was picking corn on Sabbath day, and they came to Him and said, oh, Master, you are working on the Sabbath day. They didn't know He was Sabbath. He said, the Son of Man is the Lord of Sabbath. The church you go to, you are going to me. So if you see me, you don't need to go to church. Hallelujah. So when he has met the God of his father in Bethel, why should he go and struggle? This was a man that was carrying the destiny of his grandfather Abraham. The Bible says God said Abraham, when he met him in Genesis 22, he said, blessed be Abraham, the possessor of heaven and earth. Everything on earth is upon this man. And you are one of his bloodline. And you are going to walk to level. You walk for 20 something years. In pain. And the Bible says in Genesis 31, and Jacob became a servant. That was the lowest level of his life. He doesn't need to serve anybody. People are serving his father back home. Isaac has servants everywhere, have maids and people working in their farm. But Jacob left. But when he came back in Genesis 31, he came to that same place. He knew that place was somewhere. He sent his family away and said, I'm going to stay here today. I know I saw something last time I passed by this way. I wish I see something again. He was in the vision praying all night. And the man showed up and said, I've seen you before. God showed up again. That was El Shaddai. He said, I will never leave you unless you bless me. I know that I missed you before, but this time I'm not missing you anymore. I've wasted 20 something years that I don't need to waste because I missed my future. My future is here. I will never leave you unless you bless. The man looked at him and said, what is your name? Because God bless us by our name and lineage. The tribe where you come from, that's how your blessing is done. What is your name? He said, my name is Jacob. God said, all of a sudden, a man that did not know his name for 20 something years knew his name. What is your name? The last time his father asked him that question, God was speaking to him. He would have received his blessing when his father said, and he spoke. His father said, no, the voice is the voice of Esau. He said, come, Jacob, I'm touching. He said, the body is the body of Esau, but the voice is the voice of Jacob. He said, what is your name? He said, I am Esau, my son. He lied. His father blessed Esau. So the blessing never came to Jacob. The blessing went to the name. What is your name? Esau. Wow. So for 20-something years, he was running around thinking he has carried blessing, but he has carried curse. For lying to God, he carried cause. So that day he corrected it. What is your name? If you are saying Esau, Jacob will never become anything. He will be useless on earth. But what is your name? My name is Jacob. God said, wow, all of a sudden, as a prince, because Jacob was a prince, a son of God, principality. He said, as a prince, thou have fought with God and with man, and thou have prevailed. You shall be called Israel. Your destiny is coming now. you have passed this exam. From that day, his life changed for good. I said, today we are not going to hold on to Saul. We shall leave Saul so we can enter into David. David is the next frontier. David is the next generation. David is the new place. We cannot continue to hold on to Saul, our father. Why? We have our future standing at us. It's time to say, Father, thank you, you have done so well. But I got to say, I'm going to believe. You have been nice to me. You have taken care of me. You came back to me. You trained me. You did all that. I love you, Daddy. But it's time for me to face my future. Because my future is now. If Jonathan has said goodbye to his father, he would have reigned with David. If you read down, the Bible says every useless person that came to David, the Bible says vain men, men that were battered, men that were destroyed, men that were distressed, they came to David, 400 men. They came back as mighty men of David. Every one of them became mighty because the covenant was upon this guy. So Jonathan would have cleared into that, but he looked at his father. He loved his father. He didn't want to leave him. Sometimes your past has gone so well, but you got to say it is enough. You took care of me for these years. I got to leave you. You have been great for me. My past, you have done so much. You took me to school. You took me to all these great things. We have fought. We have experiences together. But it's time for me to move forward to my future. My future is now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Hallelujah. Can we just stand on our feet? We're going to pray now. And remember when the decree was made in Daniel chapter 3. And the Jews were in captivity in Babylon. And the Bible said, these three guys, they were not even in the same location. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They heard the decree of the king, say, well, the king changed our name, it's okay. He took us into captivity, we are fine. He changed our language, we are good, but he cannot change our God. They said, our God is our future. If we lose our God, that's it. They said, we will not bow to this idol. Even though this land has been blessing us, we have been working and making money here, but we will not bow. And they gathered them and brought them in front of the king. And Nebuchadnezzar looked at them in verse 24. And Nebuchadnezzar said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they say, yeah, okay, we are not even careful to answer you. We are not in a hurry. Our God will save us. He will deliver us. But even if our God will not deliver us, we will not bow. Because our God is our future. You are our past. You took us captive. You took everything from us. You brought us into a foreign land. We cannot. And the Bible said they bundled them and put them in the lake of fire. And the fire was burning, but they were dancing in fire. I don't know how many of you have been put in fire. You have been in fire before they put you in fire. If you stay with God, you have been in fire. Because when God comes to you, the Bible says our God is a consuming fire. He put fire on you. How many of you are already burning, but you don't know that fire is upon you. So when they throw you into that dungeon, nothing will happen to you. The Bible said they were looking at three men walking around. Number four showed up and they were dancing and singing inside fire. The king looked and said, what? Is it not three men we put here? How come we see number four? The number four is like the Son of God. He saw Jesus that day. He said, bring them out. And they came out. Not even a dust of fire. Not a smoke. Not even the smell of fire was on their clothes. Some of you have gone through worse things. But people cannot see it. And you say, I've been here. They say, you don't look like someone that spent 5 years in jail. You don't look like someone that is divorced. You don't look like somebody that has been rejected. You look so nice. Because God will protect his own. God will never let his own. You can go through a lot. He said, when you walk through the waters, I shall be with you. When you walk through fire, it shall not be kindled against you because I am with you. Amen. I want you to talk to God now. In any way, I have missed my past. Help me to get into my future. Today is a new day. It's a new month. It's a new week. God, help me. Take me to my future. Everything my past have given to me, I thank God for that. But it's time for us to move forward. It is time for us to move forward. Ask God to take you to your future. Begin to pray that prayer now by the authority and the power. In the name of Jesus, Lord, take me to tomorrow. Take me to tomorrow. Take me to tomorrow. Help me to make that decision. I know you have given me the power to decide. But Lord, I don't want to be in yesterday anymore. Yesterday might have been great, but it's time for tomorrow to appear. Help me to find my next tomorrow. me to go into my future. As I live here, I step into my future. I reject every part of my past by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus. Rakata sikata baba, rebaga shakare mama, maksokoto lo bobo, lekete sikata baba, rebaga shakata basekeleba, rakata sikana nami kalema. I'm walking into my future. I am coming out. God said, get out of thy father's house. Say, I am coming out. I am coming out of my past. I am coming out today. I am entering into my future. Rekata rababa, rabogo sokoto bobo, rekete shekete baba. I am coming out of my past. I'm walking into my future. My future is bright. And I need it now. I walk into my future. Thank you. Thank God for your gospel. Thank you for tomorrow has been secured. Tomorrow is guaranteed by the unction and the power in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. You will be seated. Hallelujah.